And he's going to tell us about authentication by means of all sorts of sensor things and power consumption in agriculture.
This is not really my work. This is the work of my student, Rahul Murmuria. I'm here to present because, I mean, he's part of my group at CryptoWire. His wife is expecting, so he couldn't make the trip. So yes, that's why I'm a session chair and I'm presenting today. I'm covering for him. So today what I'm going to talk about is a technology that we developed as part of a DARPA grant for continuous authentication in mobile devices. And with that, the problem space basically is we try to, we have all here healthcare devices. You all have these devices here. Usually to authenticate, you either need to put a PIN. Recently, Google developed, Apple developed fingerprint scanners, which, you know, you can actually log in with a fingerprint, but all of those require some sort of passwords, sometimes sensitive data. They are not definitely integrated, so basically different apps require different passwords. And also, the moment that you enter the device, and that's the crucial part, the moment I authenticate the device, any application that runs in the background can perform any activity, because from that point on, they're already there. Also, endpoint authentication models do not necessarily protect the data. They protect the device, right? The type of data considered sensitive basically depends on other things, like, you know, my documents are sensitive, but the moment I put a PIN, I automatically access everything. So actually, the idea that we had is, can we actually create an authentication system that can actually continuously authenticate the user and at the same time protect the services at different levels? Another was continuous authentication is a process of basically identifying the user repeatedly and without the user knowing that you're doing that. So basically by collecting biometrics, and the biometrics that we use are movement, touching, power, and context. Actually, one of the things that I would try to point out is that a lot of people talk about authentication, but you cannot actually have authentication unless you know which application the user is interacting with. We have done different experiments. The probability that you will be able to identify the user without knowing which application runs is probably very low, because you really don't know the layout of that application and you don't train that application. Just to give you an example, a lot of people talk about classifiers requires instances from positive and negative classes. But the truth is that if you do not know which application you are running, then you don't know how to classify the data. Again, as an example, you can play a game, or you can read email, or you can go to Facebook. These are three different activities. The way that the user interacts in all those three cases is completely different. Another thing that we have done is basically we try to connect what the user is doing in terms of power consumption, touches, gestures, movement, with gyroscope and accelerometer, with the actual authorization based on authentication. So for example, when you start with the device, you do not necessarily have access to everything. You have actually access to very little, but as you keep using the device recognizes you and allows you to do more. So for example, at the beginning, you might just browse or call 911, but as you keep using the device, you are actually able to do more. And when I say you can actually do more, we'll see from our results, we can actually detect the user within a few seconds, not a few hours or a few minutes. We have actually, the reason that we can do that is because the system that we have created is basically what is called a multimodal system, which basically takes input from what we call long-term modalities like power consumption that require a little bit more time to develop, but they provide more robustness. And then you have touch, gesture, physical movement modalities, which all vote together to create a score for you. The idea is basically that we do that as a context while we generate a profile. So for example, when you're on Facebook, you get a different context and a different authentication score, and the score is built differently than when you are at Google Chrome, for instance. And actually, as I saw, I told you, users' behavior actually varies a lot based on the different activities and different applications. The system measures the activities of the legitimate user. What does that mean? It means basically I'm giving you the phone and I let you use it for you know, for let's say an hour, and then I collect the data and I build your profile. Now, we do not use the negative profile. We never give the phone to someone else to test it, because we try to basically create a model that is basically very tight on the actual user. Now, what we have done though is we have used what's called individualized parameters and thresholds. It basically means that we can actually identify from the other, from when we create your profile, we take into consideration all the profiles we have collected from different users. And basically what we try to do is the reverse of what clustering people try to do. We try to find the dimensions where you differ from the other people. And by saying individualized parameters, basically I'm trying to decluster you from the entire population by selecting things that you are unique at. So some people are having very similar touches, but they have very different way of holding the phone. We give more weight to that. Some other people you know, use the phone very fast, and that creates a different power profile. So in other words, we're trying to find the profile parameters that make the user more unique in a set of users. And as you can understand, this basically scale has to be able to scale into thousands of users, not just 5 users or 10 users. In terms of modalities, we perform feature extraction. For power, basically, we get readings every 5 seconds aggregated as moving windows, and the calculation of the power is using voltage and current ranging from basically the drivers provided by the phone. In the movement, we use acceleration vector, rate of rotation, grouped in windows of 2 seconds. We have basically 14 features describing each window, mean, standard deviation. The way that you hold the phone and you move it to your ear is actually very well defines you in a rather unique fashion. Touches also are something that you can pair with the other events. Touches are not necessarily very unique for a set of users, but they're very easy to collect, and depending on the rate at which we use the phone, we can actually generate a lot of movements. And here's 5 features for gesture: the duration, the distance, the direction, the average pressure, and average touch area. So the average pressure is another interesting feature, because different people tend to pressure the phone surface differently at different locations. And the average touch area is another thing that is fairly characteristic, but it doesn't mean that every, I mean, you can have 2 users having similar measurements on that. In terms of analysis, what we do is basically, what happens is that you have a phone and now you start collecting data. What is the ultimate goal, right? The ultimate goal is, how quickly can I identify that someone else is using the phone? Or in other words, how quickly can I identify that you are using the phone? The idea here is that its modality is obtained basically by the phone. So basically, I don't need to contact the server. I have everything that I need in your phone. I have already created the profile. As I collect the data, compare your profile to my model here, and then I recognize you as time goes by adding points to your authentication. We're using different algorithms. One of them is Trout, and I will explain the differences, because different types of data require basically different processing. These code algorithms are better for power, for instance, and some techniques like here. In our case, we use what is called 2 out of 3 majorities. If we the 2 out of 3 modalities vote, we have found an imposter. It means that if 2 out of 3 measured modalities claim that you're outside of the model, then basically we reduce your score and you become basically an imposter, or basically you lose your ability to use the device. The non-imposter consensus means that all modalities vote for no imposter. If everybody votes that you're not an imposter, then we think that this is okay. Now, how does the movement and touch model works? The idea here is that we have a training set and a confidence level. And what we do is basically every new measurement, in this case, it would be the blue, we compare to find points in the yellow region where the measurements that we have from the normal and see the distance. In the training set, we believe basically that we use it's similar to k-means, but it's a bit different, because basically we assume that the point location is close to us, and then we try to find out how strange it is from the points we have already seen. On the Discord algorithm, it's a little bit different algorithm. What we try to see is identify anomalies. Here the anomaly is the subsequence from testing set. If the distance to its nearest neighbor in the training set lies in the tail of the baseline distribution of distances, you can see, for example, that you can have something that is very far from the confidence, and then at that point you think you consider it outside. Now, what does it look like in reality, right? The user identification, what you care about is here we have a matrix of users. You see Alice has to be able to identify itself in the matrix. So basically you compare everybody with everybody else. If you compare everybody with everybody else, you want to be able to tell. So this matrix, for example, is not a good matrix because you can see that there are people like Alice compared to Alice, the score is high, the rejected gestures is high, so we don't want that. We want basically something similar to what Bob has, because Bob has very low rejection rate with himself, but allows us to basically, the rest of the people are too high when compared to Bob. So the idea here is that we do not necessarily need, the separation happens because we want to be able to tell that the user is there, but also at the same time we need to be able to tell when someone else is using the phone. So it's not just the same thing to recognize yourself, you need to be able to reject also other people. Now, part of the problem is how do you choose thresholds, right? How do you basically identify a threshold to be able to separate yourself from everybody else? And there are two methods. You can either have a general threshold for all entries in the matrix. Basically, all your algorithms can be having the same parameters for every user, or you can actually individualize that. So basically, you can actually weigh the different modalities for each user in a way that will generate a unique model. Now, another problem that we have is that you don't want to be locking out the regular user from the phone. Actually, that's the worst thing that can happen. Someone using the phone, you keep false rejecting him, may mean that while the user is using the phone, you cannot recognize that it's the actual user, then you have a false reject, and you do not want that. On the other hand, you do not want to have a false accept, right? You don't want someone else to pick up the phone and be recognized as a regular user. But in our case, we believe that these are not the actual good questions to ask. In reality, what you care about is the following. Can a good user, was there ever a case where a good user was prevented from doing an action while he was actually using the phone? And vice versa, is there any case where a bad guy was able to use the phone to do something that was not allowed to do while the models were running? And then basically, we calculate the false accept rate and false reject rate, and we vary the threshold of the matrices to allow us to perform basically the analysis. So here, the most interesting part was that we had actually 73 volunteers from GMU that they used the form in 2 45-minute sessions. And that's interesting because a lot of people, they were given access to different applications. One thing that we never thought of, and actually becomes a very interesting modality, is that different users use different applications, exchange different applications, swap different applications in the device differently. So for example, many people use Maps directly or through Google search. Also, we found out that a lot of people swap from Mail to Facebook or Facebook to Chrome in a way that basically is predictable across time but is unique to their profile. So in other words, the way that we use the applications is another modality that you can actually put there. All the tasks were performed by volunteers were sitting down, no content was recorded outside of the sensory data, and the profiles were generated using 60% of data for every user and remaining 40% for the testing. You can see here for 45 minutes, that means basically we had few minutes to test, to train, and few minutes to actually test, which allowed us to create models that are very small but very robust, as I will show you. Indeed, if you take a look at the results, for Chrome specifically, the the majority, so the non-imposter consensus was actually having a very low error ER, which is basically the error rate. We had a false eject rate of 0 and a false accept rate less than 0.8%. So here you can see that different applications, of course, we have different results for different applications. The applications were fairly consistent individually, but when I summed up the applications, for example, I removed what I call the application context, I was then getting measurements without considering what application they were using, the data become not very deterministic, the accuracy of the data drops. That's why, for example, when we heard the Google I.O. Announcement that they will actually start using, you know, touches and other authentication, biometric authentication, but without taking into consideration the application context, to me, that is very, it's not going to be accurate, because the way that we use the applications actually significantly changes the way that the measurements have to be collected and considered. And if you take a look at the individual modalities, without combining the modalities, then you get again bad results. And the reason is because different users are unique at different modalities. So each one of us we cannot necessarily create a unique representation if we take only the touches, because the touches themselves, they are not enough, they don't contain enough information to be able to convey the uniqueness of the user. You have basically, when you separately each modality is a weak identifier. You have actually to pull out the individual weak. In other words, the average person on any single modality will have protection demand, but if you create all three modalities and weigh them appropriately, you get a unique profile. And finally, what I will talk is the integration of application authorization. We do believe, as I said, I don't believe in the question, can I recognize you or not? The real question is, when can I recognize you? In other words, is there a case where a regular user was blocked while trying to access an application? Because the truth is that you do not need to have high authentication score if you do not access high sensitive information. Like if you just browse, 90% of what you do on the phone does not require high authentication. But in many cases, when you use your banking application or when you use sensitive documents, you do need to have high authentication. Conversely, even if you can, if you make a mistake and for like 0.5 seconds you allow someone to use the device, what can someone do in these 0.5 seconds before it becomes catastrophic for the phone? He was able to access sensitive data, or he was just able to browse? So the real question is, what can an attacker or an imposter do on your phone, and at what level of information there is information leaked or activities performed that are sensitive? And here you can see we have implemented, all of this is implemented. And you can see, for example, that the authentication score indicates, for example, how well it's a score that goes from 0 to 100, 100 being that you are exactly who we think you are, where 0 means that you are probably an imposter. And actually, this score varies across time. As a future work, we want to study the impact of the performance when we allow volunteers to perform their daily routine tasks. I can tell you that we have started that experiment. We actually, nowadays, we give the phone out to people for like a week's worth of time, and we allow them to install any application that they want. We can perform, we need much longer data collection sessions where the volunteer uses the device over multiple days. Investigate the scalability of the individualized parameters, meaning that if I have 10,000 users, how easy it is for me to extract a unique mode, extract parameters that make my A user unique compared to the rest 9,999. Speed up the calculations to have different methods, and basically, I would add one more is the power that is consumed by this application right now is like at 1%. We want to drop it less than that. Ideally, we want to drop it basically to less than, I would say, less than a few minutes for a charge cycle. Versus right now, it's probably you lose basically 20 to 30 minutes at 1%. So, I mean, that's challenging because basically you have to run online, but all of those are part of our ongoing work. And with that, I will take questions.
authentication, but I think from your talk, I'm not quite understand why you talk, you mentioned it as continuous authentication.
Because we collect the biometric data that I discussed, we collect every second. So basically, as you type, as you touch, we create your score. This authentication score is being updated as you use the device and you move. As we collect data from the sensors, the authentication, you have an authentication score, and actually the applications are informed automatically. In other words, if you drop below a specific value, you might lose capability to access documents or the camera, or depending on the policy. So that's why it's continuous.
Okay, so that it's not like it's not like a service that we have to use it when we use the phone, right? I mean, you have to continuous monitoring the status.
We do. That's why I said that.
Yeah. So that will introduce another problem that in a smartphone we usually complain about the battery. So I'm wondering the power consumption of your continuous authentication on smartphone.
Yeah, I said that we currently are at 1%, and we would like to drop that to 1% of the total duration of the phone. So for example, if you use the phone, it's 24 hours, we basically need something like half an hour, the entire duration of the phone. So basically we have less than 1%, it's 1%, and we try to drop it basically to less than 1%. And it depends on the device. For instance, for phone might be more pronounced. For a tablet is already low, but for a phone is more, because the phone has a smaller battery. So it has to do also, and also for larger phone, if you have like a 6, it's smaller percentage of the battery. The smaller phones, bigger percentage of the battery, because you have to run it and collect the data. But it's just 1%.
So do you have any evaluation on this part? I mean, like overhead?
Not on this paper, but I'm happy to share with you. We have a technical report, yes.
Hi, Tatiana from Authentication. Well, while I was hearing you talk, I had the impression that this technique can be also used by malicious attackers in the context of side channel attack. Because sensors like accelerometers or power meter can be accessible without any permission requirements. So my question was, have you considered such malicious way of using your technique, and how you can prevent such attacks?
So, in our work, we have not considered, but other people have done it. So they have looked into side channels from using of power and accelerometer. The issue with the side channel is that you need some sort of consistency in the way that the data are produced. And because the user is not necessarily consistent locally, but it can be consistent, you know, on average. So people have to develop techniques that basically the data are transmitted on average. So even in our case, the exact way that you use the device, that you move the phone, is not very robust, but the trajectories. So we have to basically create high level things, because the trajectories are. So I don't stop always like this, but the way that I move is a feature. So yes, people have not looked into that. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Prajit Hong from Stanford University. With human behavior changing constantly over time, do you have some measure of freshness of your data? Like, do you age out old data?
Thank you. It's a very good question. We actually, I can give you anecdotal evidence that are not in the paper. So actually at the beginning, when we started the study, we actually had a lot of cases where we get data that the user does not match. And that happened, for example, Friday night, when the users were going out and drinking a little bit more. So the data were not necessarily exactly the same as the morning of Friday. So what we found out is really dependent on the user. Sometimes it's diurnal, so for example, Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays, you might have completely different behavior. It can be also location-based. What you do at work and what you do at home is completely different. And what we found out that usually you can retrain, or you can actually refresh your model weekly, and that will keep it fresh. But really depends on the activity of the user. For example, some people have accidents and then they start using the phone differently, so that contributes, of course. But I mean, that's part of the, that's why I said that sometimes it's not just collecting the data or comparing it. You have to give a context. That's why, for example, the fact that you know that Friday night might be a different night is important, and you cannot just apply the same technique all over.
Thank you.
So, one more question. I was wondering, you've tried two applications that are somewhat similar, I guess, in profile, right?
Yeah, that's actually in the paper and the technical report. we have more applications that are further up. For example, if you play a game versus Facebook, because one is structured and the other one is not that structured, it's easy to separate. But if you go into applications like Chrome and Facebook that are similarly structured, like have a portion that is structured, then you click in on the corners and then you click in the middle, then it's much more difficult to separate. So that's why we use those two as a benchmark. I mean, there are other applications which are much easier to force the user to exhibit individualized behavior. But the real question is what they do in real apps.
What I was wondering about is, you know, for some applications, these features might not be the best ones.
Okay, perfect. That's why we say that basically you have to train the system. For example, in some games, touches is best, where power is not important at all. In some other cases, accelerometers, if the game is basically involving movement.
Or you know, completely.
I mean, you have all the spectrum. That's why I don't think that when I said that Google, if they try to do it without having the context awareness, is not going to work out very well, because that, I mean, creates completely different profiles. I mean, you can imagine that playing a game and watching the movie or going to Facebook, three different activities require different inputs.
So we completely agree. That's fantastic. Let's all thank the speaker.